So that makes it kind of hard for us to embrace ourselves and to embrace other people. And the Word of God does not, it does not hold back whenever it speaks about man's evil deeds. We can see that all through the scriptures. But it also doesn't demonize humanity, you know, as humanity as a race that can be redeemed or can be saved. It teaches that we're made in the image of God, that we're utterly loved by Him. But it also shows us, along with reality, that we're limited and frail creatures, prone to self-destruction and hatred. Today we're going to see that through the life of David. You know, we see a man who is known for his greatness, and also a man known for his demise and for his weaknesses. So, and the story of David is written in the book of Samuel, 1 Samuel, if you want to turn to it. It's written after the time period of the judges. So we're going to be in the book of 1 Samuel, chapter 6, I mean 16. Saul. But so let's look at it. So we're in 1 Samuel chapter 16, verses. Let's read from verses 14 to 23. And I'll go ahead and read it. Now the Spirit of the Lord had departed from Saul, and an evil spirit from the Lord tormented him. Saul's attendant said to him, "See, an evil spirit from God is tormenting you. Let our Lord command his servants here to search for someone who can play the lyre. He will play when the evil spirit from God comes on you, and you will feel better." So Saul said to his attendants, "Find someone who plays well and bring him to me." One of the servants answered, "I have seen a son of Jesse of Bethlehem, who knows how to play the lyre. He is a brave man and a warrior. He speaks well and is a fine-looking man, and the Lord is with him." Then Saul sent messengers to Jesse and said, "Send me your son David, who is with the sheep." So Jesse took a donkey loaded with bread, a skin of wine, and a young goat, and sent them with his son David to Saul. David came to Saul and entered his service. Saul liked him very much, and David became one of his armor bearers. Then Saul sent a word to Jesse, saying, "Allow David to remain in my service, for I am pleased with him." Whenever the spirit from God came on Saul, David would take up his lyre and play. Then relief will come to Saul, and he will feel better, and the evil spirit will leave him. So here, you know, like I said, we're going to be speaking about the story of David. We're going to see how it is filled with wretchedness and grace, misery and despair, conflict and victory and love. David, a shepherd boy from Bethlehem, became the most famous king in the history of Israel. His victory and his demise are well known. His fight against Goliath and his power is more famous than Pacquiao's, Mayweather's, and Chavez's, and McGregor's, Mike Tyson's combined. And his failures are well known as well. They're more scandalous than O.J. Simpson, than Whitney Houston, than Donald Trump, and Bill Clinton. So his life is pretty scandalous, you know, and it's in the Bible. I told my girlfriend that it could be an HBO late night show, an HBO Sunday night program. You see, a little bit of everything. But his name is mentioned in the Bible over 8,000 times. I mean, over 800 times. He's a king whom God promises to make his kingdom eternal. And that he was a standard for the kings of Israel. A man after God's own heart. But a man nonetheless. But what was David's weakness? That he showed contempt towards his king. He was loyal to his enemy, to his death. But he scorned the cosmic king by sleeping with his neighbor's wife and by killing his dad, killing the husband. So let's go ahead and dive into David's story. So in Samuel chapter 15, we see that Saul, he's rejected by the Lord. He sinned against him and he disobeyed him twice. And therefore, God is looking for a man after his own heart. And chapter 16 is the first time that we see the name of David mentioned. They kind of present David as a really good-looking kid, very healthy, very strong, brave. Whenever Saul's servants call him to Saul, they also tell him, you know, this guy can play the lyre. He's known to be courageous and a great warrior. So we see here, let's see, verses 21 to 24. If somebody would like to read it.
Hey, 21 to 24?
Yes.
Okay. When David came to Saul and entered his service, Saul liked him very much, and David became one of his armor bearers. Then Saul sent word to Jesse, saying, "Allow David to remain in my service, for I am pleased with him." Whenever the spirit from God came on Saul, David would take up his lyre and play. Then relief would come to Saul. He would feel better, and the evil spirit would leave him.
So we see here, you know, the entry of David, a well-looking, good-looking kid, and also how God departed from Saul. And we see in verses, whenever David gets anointed by Samuel, it says that the Spirit of God came on him powerfully. And what does that mean? And one commentary just explains how it's just Spirit in the Old Testament just means wind. And kind of the invisible moving in the visible. And we see that in the life of David since the beginning. Whenever he starts working for Saul, he's still working for his dad as well. He has like a little part-time job. You know, it's all service. But we see that he's becoming successful. And we see that Saul, he's being, the Lord casted an evil spirit to kind of torment him. And it was David who brought relief to him. You know, which is pretty interesting, you know. David is coming into Saul, and Saul will soon become envious of him. So in chapter 17, that's whenever he defeats Goliath. It's a pretty well-known story. And it will be his first victory over his first war victory. So what I want to give you a picture of is just David's righteousness, and then David's sinfulness. So we first see that through the story of him and Jonathan. Let me see that. So if you can turn to chapter 18 of 1 Samuel. First Samuel chapter 18.
32.
So in chapter 18, we see here Jonathan's commitment to David, and how pretty much we see a glimpse of true love, you know, the true friendship of true even if David's gonna take Jonathan's position, you know, we see how Jonathan commits to David by giving him his robe, his tunic, and his sword, his bow, and his belt. A symbol of Jonathan's approval of his friend and a symbol of commitment to the true good of each other. And Jonathan's love is reflected when he defends him from his dad and he helps David. And in chapter 19, when Saul makes his plan public that he wants to destroy David, we see how Jonathan defends David. And another reflection of David's righteousness. So we see Jonathan's relationship with David, and I feel a little lost. So we see that fear of David becomes more irrational and more irrational. First, because he tries to kill his son Jonathan, and then he goes to the land of Nob, where the priest of God meet, and that's where they worship God. And that's in chapter 20. Chapter 22. So here again we see the priest of the Lord defending David, you know. Saul's looking for David, David is hiding, and the priest also defends David. He says that, you know, who else but David is your most loyal dude in your army, you know? In your household, he's well respected. In your family respects him. The country respects him, you know? And again, it's a reflection of Saul's stubbornness and foolishness and his detachment from reality. And we see David as well being defended again and again for his righteousness, for his faithfulness, for God being with them. And then we see more of David's righteousness and his faithfulness. Whenever Saul tries to attack him, and first in chapter 24. By the way, anyone has a question or a comment? Any questions or comments? So we see in chapter 24, in verses 16 to 21, this is like the third time that Saul tries to attack David, and they are in. So I don't know if somebody would like to read chapter 24, verses 16 to 21.
As soon as David finished speaking these words to Saul, Saul said, "Is this your voice, my son David?" And Saul lifted up his voice and wept. And he said to David, "You are more righteous than I, for you have repaid me good, whereas I have repaid you evil. And you have declared this day how you have dealt well with me, and that you cannot kill me when the Lord put me into your hands. For if a man finds his enemy, will he let him go away safe? So may the Lord reward you with good for what you have done to me this day. And now, behold, I know that you shall surely be king, and that the kingdom of Israel shall be established in your hand. Swear to me, therefore, by the Lord, that you will not cut off my offspring after me, and that you will not destroy
here, Saul himself tells David, you know, you're a righteous man. You know, you had me, I am your enemy, and you had me in your hands. And God delivered me to you. Yet you chose not to kill me. And it happens maybe twice in the story where David has a chance to kill him, and he chooses not to. And he keeps saying, no, how can I touch the Lord's anointed? You know? And here, I mean, back in the Old Testament, I mean, he had the chance of killing him. He had all the power to kill him as well. But we see here that, I mean, he's obeying a commandment from the New Testament, you know, where Jesus tells us to love our enemies with him without even knowing that. You know, so this is just to show David's righteousness and David's good character. But then we jump to chapter, you don't have to read it, chapter 25. And this is a pretty interesting story. I had never really paid attention to it until I studied for this lesson. And this is kind of like a contrast between Saul and this character. His name is Nabal. And this guy, his name means foolish, fool. And I mean, it's kind of like he's a fool, he's wealthy. And whenever David is hiding from Saul in the wilderness, he was taking care of this guy's sheep and this guy's man. And so David says, you know what? We're in the wilderness. We need some resources. We need food. I have my own man that need some sort of food, you know? So they come to this rich guy, whose name is Nabal, and tell them, hey, we've taken care of your sheep. We've taken care of your man. Give us some food, you know? It's time to... I think there was some sort of festival going on at that time. So they wanted to party, you know, they wanted to relax, they wanted to enjoy some sort of food. But his name means fool, you know, he's like, I don't know you, you're a stranger to me, you know, how can I give my servants food to some people that I don't know? I'm not gonna do that. And this, commentators explained how this kind of contrasts, let me go ahead. And David says, David says, what the heck, you know, I just risked my life for your people in the wilderness, you know, there's bandits there, there's renegades, there's a lot of danger, you know, we've risked our life to protect your man and your sheep, we should just serve some sort of food. So we see a little bit of David's self-righteousness here, you know, so he says, you know what, let's get strapped, you know, we're going to go kill this guy, you know, we're going to go, let me get my sword, you know, everybody get your sword, you know, we're going to go kill this guy, you know, he's paying us evil for good, you know, kind of what Saul was doing. But we see how David reacted so differently from Saul to this guy, you know. David is like, oh no, you're the Lord's anointed, you know, I'm not going to touch you, I can't touch you. The Lord avenged me, you know, the Lord is with me, the Lord's going to bring me, he's going to do something about it, you know. But we see here, not the beautiful young man, or the righteous and the man of justice. You know, we see a man who's so righteous, full of himself. You know, like, I'm gonna kill this guy. You know, he owes, in a sense, he owes me, and I'm the king. You know, but and I like how a commentator placed it. You know, because this guy is married to a very intelligent woman and very beautiful as well, and she hears about the situation, so she kind of tries to mediate between David and his men. I mean, David and her husband. And this is what David says. This is pretty... this is what a commentary says about the wife. Yeah, she becomes the person who calls David back to himself, his real self, and helps David recover his true identity. For she helped him not to take matters upon his own hands. And he tells her, maybe, and David tells her, may you be blessed by your good judgment and keeping me from bloodshed this day and from avenging myself with my own hands. After Nabal died, you know, because God killed him, God himself too, you know. Kind of like foreshadowing Samuel dying in the future, Saul dying in the future. And So, and this is what David responds once he finds out that this guy is dead. Praise be to the Lord who has upheld my cause against Nabal for treating me with contempt. He has kept his servant from doing wrong and has brought Nabal's wrongdoing on his own head. Yeah, it's pretty much, and you read that in the Psalms as well, you know, where David prays against his enemies, you know, crushing their jaws. It's pretty intense. But you know, David is thanking God here, you know, and he's going to do the same with Saul. And like I said, you know, this incident displays David's weak flesh. And if God would have not killed this guy, and if the wife would have not intervened, David would have been guilty of bloodshed, and he would have acted as the God of justice, the God of who seeks vengeance for the innocent. He would have forgotten who he truly is, a man after God's own heart, but a man nonetheless. It is, and this kind of foreshadows 2 Samuel, where we see more of David's humanity, David's fallenness as a creature, a fallen creature. And his sin is pretty famous, like I said. And it's written in 2 Samuel chapter 11, where we see that he sees, the Bible says that it's the time of war, and David decides to stay at home. And while he's chilling in his porch, he sees a woman naked, taking a shower. He uses his power to get to send for her. You know, who's this chick? You know, she's really gorgeous. She's, you know, and they tell him who she is. So they bring her to his house, and you know, they make brownies. And then but she ends up. But she ends up pregnant, you know, and David finds out. And her husband is in the war, and David is at home, and he's trying to resolve this and that, kind of hide it. So he sends for her husband, and he kills him, you know. So, you know, we come from the innocent, good-looking young man who's healthy and play the lyre so beautifully, and who can bring relief to the king, and who can be such an excellent kid, you know, with a good resume, you know. Oh, I've killed bears, I've killed tigers, I've defended my lions, I've defended my sheep, you know, I've killed a giant, I've killed a thousand people, I've defended the people of God, I've shown justice to the oppressed. A man after God's own heart committed this, you know. Not only that he neglected his duty as a king, he also committed adultery, and he also killed a man, an innocent man, you know. David, who was calling out for God's justice, you know, and God's justice. We see that he falls as well, and we see that he commits a worse sin than Saul's. It's pretty, like I said, scandalous. And we don't have to be chilling on a rooftop, you know, to see a naked girl or a boy. We can just do a little Google search. It's the truth, you know. And I'm not, you know, we can scroll through Facebook or Instagram or, you know, look at things that we're not supposed to. I can, you know, it's, and I'm no one to condemn, you know, but I'm here is to present a picture of somebody who was glorified, but also somebody who was a man nonetheless. And I can testify from my own personal story that, you know, just like David's sin affected his own family, you know, we see how his own son wants to take the kingdom from him, and his own son rapes his own daughter as well. And this is in the Bible. time, you see how God doesn't run away from reality. You know, this is what reality that we see on TV. You know, this is what we see on ourselves as well, our ability to treat others with contempt, and also, you know, whenever we ourselves are treated with contempt, you know, there's a paradox of life, and the Bible kind of accounts for it at all. You know, it gives a pretty awesome picture, not an awesome picture, but like a very awesome picture to the life of David. So this is kind of like my concluding thoughts. You know? So in the place of David, you know, after David commits his sin, God kills his son. We can put King David in the same category of O.J. Simpson, you know, Whitney Houston, people, Bill Cosby, Princess Diana, Bill Clinton, Donald Trump, you know, Demi Lovato, Tiger Woods, Martin Luther King Jr., men who did a lot of great things, you know, men who were very gifted, men who, and women who have changed history and have left a mark in history, but men with deep flaws, you know, men with deep character flaws. And David is still, I mean, he was in the lineage of Jesus, you know, and his own. And it's kind of interesting, you know, we read Psalms 8, you know, and it says, you know, who are you, God, you know, that you think of us? You made us little lower than the angels and crowned us with glory and honor. Yet, you know, like Romans 3, yet we have rebelled against you. None of us do the right thing. According to your standards, we all have fallen short and don't measure up. Yet, like David, we have received grace and mercy, and we're blessed because of transgressions, and our sins are covered. We can confess our sins, just like David, and not hide our iniquity, and we are forgiven. We're embraced by the Creator, and we're deeply loved, even though we're deeply broken and deeply flawed, just like David and just like all those famous people who have been scandalous, you know? And even though, I can conclude with this, you know, even though King David was not a perfect man, and he was not a perfect king, you know, we do have a perfect king who was human flesh, you know, so he can sympathize with our weaknesses and our flaws, even though he never sinned. But he's also God, and he can be the only one that can give us hope, you know. Like I had a teacher that told us, you know, or that told me, or the congregation, you know, whenever we say that God is holy, it shouldn't be for us to be scared, you know, it should be hope. Why? Because he's the only one that can help us. He's the only one that is different from. He's the only one that is perfect, and yet he still embraces us. He still decided to come to the nitty-gritty and kind of live real life HBO with us, you know? But yeah, that's kind of like.
Jesus took on flesh, just like Mario said, and instead of us trying to venture after the heart of God, Jesus came to earth after your heart and after my heart. That we in our brokenness can be saved, that we in our brokenness can be made whole. In our flaws, God can redeem those and mold those into something beautiful. He takes our weaknesses and makes them his strengths. Let's pray. Father, thank you so, so much for the life of David, that it was a real person in history,
who had flaws and character flaws just like us. Help us to take hope. Help us to take joy in the fact that you and you alone are perfect, and you alone are able to save us, and you alone are worthy of our praise. God, you have no weaknesses. You have nothing but strength and strong love towards us. Help us to rejoice in that. Help us to live in that. Help us to model that to other people. That we may be weak, but you are strong. God, please be with these students this week as they have tons and tons of stuff going on in their lives. I pray that you would be their strength. It's in Jesus' name that I pray. Amen. Awesome. Hey, we're going to wrap up. We're going to clean up real quick, and then we're going to get on out. And as you're on your way out, tell Mario what an amazing, amazing job. I really have to go. Can we meet sometime soon?
Yes.
Okay. When are you up here? I know you're up here like